I want to thank everyone for joining us today. And today we'll be rolling out our ambitious agenda to help support New York's families. First of all, I want to recognize all the members of the Senate Democrats who are standing here with me today. We have Senator, let me start with, I guess, I'll start from my right. Senator Liz Krueger, Senator Daniel Squadron, Senator Neil Breslin, Senator Brad Hoylman, our Deputy Leader, Senator Gianaris, our newest member, Senator Prasad, Senator Addabbo, and behind is Senator Comrie. So we're here because we're talking about supporting New Yorkers, young families, and the youngest New Yorkers. Study after study has demonstrated that the prenatal to pre-K years are vital to a child's long-term development. That's why I charged the Senate Democratic Policy Group to review what New York State currently does to support children and young families during their formative years and to generate proposals to provide greater assistance. So I really want to thank the policy group for their hard work and recognize the group's chair, Senator Daniel Squadron, and the policy group members who include Senator George Latimer, Senator Velmanette Montgomery, and Senator Jose Serrano. The findings of the policy groups helped lead to the initiatives that we are going to be outlining today, and they're included in the legislative agenda that will be distributed. As you will hear, these proposals include a strong paid family leave program, increased aid in addressing maternal depression, and a tax reform program called Child Care Advance. These common sense proposals and all of the bills we will be discussing today will help New York families better care for newborns, toddlers, preschoolers, as well as moms. And the bills outlined by my colleagues here today are not political, they're not partisan. We believe they are simply good initiatives that will improve the lives of New York families. So that's why I'm hopeful that the Senate Republicans will join with us to pass these bills and to take meaningful steps to help children during these vital formative years. So now, let me begin by introducing my deputy leader, Senator Mike Gianaris. Senator Gianaris.
Thank you, Leader. First, let me thank Leader Stewart Cousins for organizing this group and Senator Squadron and the senators who are members of it for doing such good work. We know this is just one of a series of policy initiatives they're going to be unfolding for us as a result of their work. One of the great needs that exists in society is for working families to get assistance when a child is born and in the formative years of that child. The economic burdens are great. Oftentimes, parents are thrust with a massive additional burden on their budgets that they didn't necessarily expect and anticipate would be as large as they are. And the proposals outlined in this white paper today will go a long way towards helping resolve them, whether it's dealing with taking time off from work to deal with a newborn, or providing some economic assistance to parents who need childcare, or any of the other host of initiatives in this paper. We think this is a good proposal to help with a great need that is often left unmet in our society. So I want to thank all the senators who are here and all those who couldn't be here but who worked on this proposal today. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Senator Gianaris. And as we discussed, I wanted to first start by introducing the Policy Committee's chair, Senator Dan Squadron, who will be talking about this new program, Child Care Advance. Senator Squadron.
Thank you very much. And first of all, I really want to thank Senator Stewart Cousins and our leadership for putting such a focus on policies and on finding solutions that are nonpartisan, that are realistic, that will help New Yorkers across the state get to work, help to bridge the upstate-downstate economic divide, and make a real difference for families who need it most and too often get left behind in the special interest cacophony of the Capitol. I also want to thank the members of the policy committee who have put in countless hours looking for ideas, discussing ideas, and really putting a great effort in Senator Latimer, Senator Montgomery, and Senator Jose Serrano. This set of policy initiatives is, as Senator Giannaris said, the first, as you talk about supporting families, and therefore starts at the beginning of when parents have families, from the prenatal to pre-K period, before public education and other critical issues we'll be talking about in the future take over and provide support that helps to stabilize folks. We have five ideas: family-friendly workplace practices, universal evidence-based maternal home visiting for eligible families, better identification and treatment of maternal depression, a new New York State Office of Early Childhood, and increasing access to childcare, both through increasing availability of subsidies and the quality of childcare provided with those subsidies, and through my new proposal for what we call a child care advance. The child care advance is an interest-free deferral of state taxes for young families to help support them in the costs of child care. It's a deferral that can last from the time the child is born until they begin full-time pre-K or kindergarten, and can be paid back interest-free over a 10-year period. You know, we tell families to plan for 18 years for college. We tell workers to plan for their entire working life for retirement. And we provide structures to help them do so. Most families have 9 months or less in which they're really thinking about and planning for what is often the most expensive and certainly the most challenging time in their lives, the early childhood period. It's also the most important time for children. Research shows again and again that if those early years, you have a supportive environment at home, you have high quality options outside of the home, it will change your life forever. And the lack of those things will do so for the worse. The child care advance is a way to take those child care costs, often the most expensive costs a family faces, in many cases more expensive than their housing, and provide state help for those families that might not be eligible for subsidies, but still has an enormous burden of their child care costs, on average well over $10,000 across the state, some of the highest in the nation. It's $2,000 in your pocket to help pay for child care in those years you need it. When the child care costs go down because your children are in full-time school, you pay it back interest-free over a 10-year period, and the payment for a child is completed before you have the college obligation or partnership too often with your kids begin. It's a big idea that will make a big difference for taxpayers and families across the state, and I hope the Senate Republicans don't react politically, but react by saying this is a great idea that'll make a difference for New Yorkers. Let's make it happen. Thank you. And I've ripped something. That's how right. I dropped the mic.
That's thank okay. That's right, because you know, it was an excellent presentation, and certainly, again, so key to how we are moving forward in terms of policy, making sure that we not only support the ideas that are out there, but where we can enhance them or find new ways to help make New Yorkers live better lives. That's what we want to do. And speaking of enhancing old conversations, I think I'd like at this point to ask Senator Addabbo to come forward and present the paid family leave legislation. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Leader. Thank you very much for this initiative. Thank you to our policy chair, Dan Squadron. Good afternoon. You know, obviously when we talk about paid family leave, we see such a momentum, an unprecedented momentum, that has gone on certainly from the White House down to our state here. Almost a year ago today, our governor said that Albany had no appetite for paid family leave, and now, not only is it part of his executive budget, but it's all part of our initiative here today. When we talk in terms of paid family leave, I always like to say it's not a question of if, but a question of when. Our state's going to do paid family leave. It's inevitable, and hopefully it's done this year. The bill itself just merely recognizes the realities of the workforce. You know, they're balancing the responsibilities of the work front and the home front. You know, giving 12 weeks for, to tend to that early child for a parent, a foster parent, adoptive parent, This is what our lives are all about, balancing the responsibilities. And that's what this paid family leave bill does, 12 weeks of two-thirds of the pay. Its time has come. This is something that is on, we're on the precipice of doing something monumental for our workforce throughout this state, but also for our businesses. You know, for our businesses, this provides a very, very productive worker, a high morale worker, and in a very competitive workplace. So I think this is a benefit also for the businesses as well. So again, it's not a question of if, but a question of when, and I believe when is 2016. So once again, thank you for letting paid family leave be a part of your initiative.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Senator Addabbo. I just want to recognize we were joined by a member of the Policy Committee, Senator Serrano. Thank you for being here, Senator Serrano. Next, we will hear from Senator Liz Krueger to discuss her fight to better address maternal depression. Senator Krueger.
Thank you, everyone. Well, I'm very proud to be part of a conference who sits down and says, what can we be doing better for the people of New York State? And actually says, we can improve the lives of children from the womb to they start school, till they start school. And one of the focuses of making sure that children get what they need in their early, most important developing years is making sure that their mothers are healthy. So I'm proud that we have already successfully taken steps to expand pregnancy coverage and insurance for every pregnant woman in the state. I'm proud that we have expanded and clarified the importance of breastfeeding and supporting newborns and their mothers through expanded rights to breastfeeding in the state. And I am proud that today we are continuing our movement to ensure that women who are suffering from maternal depression, either both in late pregnancy or after they give birth, can be assured that their healthcare providers will know how to screen them correctly and now ultimately make sure that we have a robust network of mental health care providers who can serve these women. Because here's the truth about maternal depression, and I learned it from the pediatricians in the state. It's the biggest issue they see for newborns, that when a woman comes in and is suffering maternal depression, that newborn is not getting the care they need. They see it in the inability of the child to bond, a slowness of the development of that child's brain in the very earliest, most important months of their life, failure to thrive, failure to eat right. So maternal depression is not hard to diagnose. It's critical to get treatment, both for the mother and for the future of that child. And here's what's really great about our doing more to make sure maternal depression is out there as a known issue that can be taken care of. It's the type of depression that people respond to incredibly effectively. There's lots of kinds of mental health illnesses that we still don't know that we have the answers for. Maternal depression responds to drug treatment and talk treatment incredibly rapidly, and it makes the difference in children's lives forever. So it's a win-win, and again, it's part of our platform of making sure that we're taking care of our youngest, most vulnerable by making sure that their mothers are healthy and get the supports they need. So thank you very much, Andrea Stewart Cousins and Daniel Squadron, for taking the lead on this big picture fight.
Thank you.
And I'm going back to a budget hearing.
So. Okay, well, thank you. Thank you. I know those are long and intense, so thank you for your attention. And thank you for the work on maternal depression. So next, we will hear from Senator Brad Hoylman, and Senator Hoylman will be discussing the predictability of work schedules.
Thank
Senator
you.
Hoylman.
Thank you, Madam Leader. And thank you, Senator Squadron, the Deputy Leader, and of course, Madam Andrea Stewart Cousins, for bringing the issues of children and working families to the table. You know what they say, if you're not at the table, you're on the menu. So these issues are so very important for kids and their parents. My bill, the Work Shift Fairness Act, which I carry with Assembly Member Neely Rozek, would end the practice of what's called on-call scheduling. And on-call scheduling occurs when an employer calls an employee to report to work on less than 24 hours notice. And that means if you're called within 24 hours, you have to scramble to get childcare, elder care, you got to get transportation, you have to oftentimes reschedule other jobs, you have to cancel school classes. That's incredibly disruptive to a young family. And sometimes, to add insult to injury, when that employee reports to work, the employer sends them home without any pay, and that's wrong. So time is money, obviously, and if you're gonna move your schedule around in less than 24 hours to accommodate your boss, you should get paid for it. And our bill would mandate at least 4 hours pay in those instances at least the minimum wage. It's time to start treating workers with respect and stop treating them as if they're fungible objects that can be moved around at will. Now, Attorney General Eric Schneiderman has investigated this issue thoroughly, and he's received the cooperation of some big retailers like The Gap and Target to stop the practice of on-call scheduling. But I believe, and I'm thankful that we all believe, that the legislature should take the additional step and ban this unfair practice throughout the entire state. Thank you, Madam Leader.
Thank you so much, Senator Hoylman. And again, as you can see, there's been a lot of work done in terms of the policies and the policy committee. So last but not least is our newest member, Senator Prasad. And Senator Prasad is going to discuss her bill to treat maternal depression. Senator Prasad.
Good afternoon. I am going to be talking about the protocols that should be established for treating maternal depression. Maternal depression does not only affect the mother, does not only affect the child. It affects the entire family. So it is important that we treat it. It is important that we set protocols in place. I am asking that we compile a list. When a mother goes to see a practitioner, there's too often not enough information for referrals. The practitioner does not always know who to refer the mother to. We're asking for a list to be in place, so whether it's the midwife, whether it's the doctor, it's a doctor, whether it's anyone in the office can readily select that list, and give it to the mother, and refer her to the appropriate for the appropriate treatment. We're asking for peer support. We're asking non-for-profit organizations to work with us. We're asking for community resources to be allocated so that we can take care of this issue. It's a very, very important issue. We're asking the list must be made available as public as possible. It must be readily and handily available. It must be accessible. Anyone wanting information should be able to receive that information. The list must also be updated as necessary as possible. We're not asking for a list to be compiled and then left there. So someone looking at it saying, okay, I can select X organization for assistance. And then you call X organization only to find out that organization is no longer in service. That's not what we're looking for. The list must be updated. It must always be accurate. And we're asking also for it to be placed, right, a commissioner within their existing appropriations. We're not looking to add additional funding. The resources are there for them to be able to compile this list and for them to have it readily available. The resources are there for the list to be updated. The resources are there for the list to be always accessible. Again, this is not a mother issue, it is not a child's issue, it is a family's issue. And families are integral to our communities. If we're not taking care of our families, then we are falling short on our responsibility to families. Again, thank you, Leader Stuart Cousins, for bringing us all together. And again, this is not a woman's issue, this is a family issue, this is a community's issue. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Senator Prasad. And I really want to thank all of the senators here and everyone who has really contributed to creating a package that, again, talks about the life of children and their families from the womb until past child care needs and age.